describe the structure of plasma membrane. Like all other cellular membranes, plasma membrane contains of both lipids and proteins. The fundamental structure of the membrane is the phospholipid bilayer. Which forms a stable barrier between two aqueous compartments, that is, this layer does not permit water to flow. In the case of plasma membrane, these compartments are the inside and the outside of the cell. Proteins embedded within the phospholipid bilayer carry out the specific function of the plasma membrane. Proteins embedded within the phospholipid bilayer carry out the specific functions of the plasma membrane. Which includes selective transport of molecules, and cell-cell recognition. Now, some things about the phospholipid bilayer. The plasma membrane is the most thoroughly studied of all cell membranes, and it is largely through investigation of the plasma membrane that our current concept of membrane structure have evolved. The plasma membranes of mammalian red blood cells, that is the erythrocytes, have been particularly useful as a model for studying membrane structure. Now, mammalian red blood cells do not contain nuclei or internal membranes. So they represent a source from which pure plasma membrane can be easily isolated for biochemical analysis. Indeed, biological membranes. Indeed, the study of red blood plasma membrane provided the first evidence that biological membrane consists of lipid layers. In 1925, two Dutch scientists, namely E. Gorter and R. Grendel, extracted the membrane lipids from a known number of red blood cells corresponding to a known surface area of plasma membrane. They then determined the surface area occupied by a monolayer of the extracted lipids spread out at an air-water interface. The surface area of the lipid monolayer turned out to be twice that occupied by the erythrocyte plasma membrane, leading to the conclusion that the membranes consisted of lipid bilayer rather than monolayer. So the experiment was based on numerical values, which was able to prove that lipid layer is not a monolayer, it is a bilayer. It was calculated by calculating the surface area ratio. The bilayer structure of the erythrocyte plasma membrane is clearly evident in high magnification electron micrograph. The plasma membrane appears as two dense lines separated by an intervening space, a morphology frequently referred to as a railroad track appearance. Railroad track appearance is the term morphologically used for the space between two lipid layers in the plasma membrane. Space between plasma membrane, lipid layer of bilayer of plasma membrane. This leads the plasma membrane of the animal cell contains four major phospholipids: phosphatidylcholine, phosphatidyl ethanolamine, and phosphatidyl serine and sphingomyelin. They together account for more than half of the lipid in most membranes. These phospholipids are asymmetrically distributed between the two halves of the membrane layer. The outer leaflet of the plasma membrane contains mainly of phosphatidylcholine and sphingomyelin. So the outer leaflet, and this is for animal cells, it contains phosphatidyl serine and sphingomyelin, whereas the phosphatidyl ethanolamine and phosphatidyl serine are the predominant phospholipids of the inner leaflet. So in the inner leaflet we have phosphatidyl ethanolamine and phosphatidyl serine. Now there is a fifth phospholipid named phosphatidyl inositol, is also localized on the inner half of the plasma membrane. Although phosphatidyl inositol is a quantitatively minor membrane component, it plays an important role in cell signaling, as will be discussed further. The head groups of both phosphatidyl serine and phosphatidyl inositol are negatively charged, so their predominance in the inner leaflet results in a net negative charge on the cytosolic face of the plasma membrane. So there is a net negative charge on the cytosolic face. In addition to phospholipid, the plasma membrane of animal cell contains glycolipids and cholesterol. So phospholipids plus glycolipids plus cholesterol. The glycolipids are found exclusively in the outer part, with their carbohydrate portion exposed on the cell surface. They are minor membrane components, constituting only 2%. Cholesterol, on the other hand, is a major membrane constituent of the animal cell, being present in about the same molar amount as the phospholipid. Cholesterol is a major component of animal cell, present in about same molar amount as phospholipids, which means cholesterol is too necessary for the body in a limited amount. Two general features of phospholipid bilayer are critical to membrane function. First, the structure of phospholipids is responsible for the basic function of membranes as the barrier between two aqueous compartments. So, structurally, phospholipids act as a barrier between two aqueous compartments. Because the interior of the phospholipid bilayer is occupied by hydrophobic fatty acid chain, the membrane is impermeable to water soluble molecules. So, interior of phospholipid bilayer is occupied by hydrophobic fatty acid chains which makes the membrane impermeable to water soluble molecules. Including ions. As well as biological molecules. The second bilayer of the naturally occurring phospholipids are viscous fluid, not solids. So, not the second. The bilayers of the naturally occurring phospholipids are viscous fluids and not solids. This you must have studied in the fluid mosaic model. They are not rigid. They are in a quasi-static condition. So this is an important point. Bilayer of phospholipid is a viscous fluid, not solid. The fatty acid of most natural phospholipids have one or more double bonds which introduce kinks into the hydrocarbon chain and make them difficult to pack together. The long hydrocarbon chain of the fatty acid therefore moves freely in the interior of the membrane, so the membrane itself is soft and flexible. So because their packing together is not so efficient, it allows them to move freely in the interior of the membrane. That is what makes it soft as well as flexible. So the fatty acids have one or more double bond, which introduces kinks into hydrocarbon chain, making it difficult to pack together. The long hydrocarbon chain of the fatty acids move freely in the interior, so the membrane is soft and flexible. In addition, both the phospholipid as well as the proteins are free to diffuse laterally within the membrane, a property that is critical for many membrane functions. Now, because of the rigid ring structure, cholesterol plays a distinct role in membrane structure. Cholesterol will not form a membrane by itself, but inserts into a bilayer of phospholipids with its polar hydroxyl group close to the phospholipid head group. Now, depending on the temperature, cholesterol has distinct effects on membrane fluidity. Cholesterol has distinct effects on membrane fluidity. At high temperature, cholesterol interferes with the movement of phospholipid fatty acid chain, making the outer membrane less fluidic, reducing its permeability only to small molecules. So, at high temperature, the permeability reduces. High temperature, less permeability. So, at low temperature, it will show reverse effects. By interfering with interaction between fatty acid chain, cholesterol prevents membrane from freezing and as well as maintains the membrane fluidity. Although cholesterol is not present in bacteria, it is an essential component of animal cell plasma membrane. Plant cells also lack cholesterol, but they contain related compounds, which are different groups of sterols that fulfill a similar function. Recent studies suggest that not all lipids diffuse freely in the plasma membrane. Instead, discrete membrane domains appear to be enriched in cholesterol and sphingolipids. These clusters of sphingolipids and cholesterol are thought to form rafts that move laterally within the plasma membrane and may associate with specific membrane proteins. Although the function of lipid raft remains to be understood, they may play an important role in processes such as cell signaling and uptake of extracellular molecules by endocytosis. Membrane proteins. While lipids are the fundamental structural elements of membranes, proteins are responsible for carrying out specific membrane function. So, structural elements were lipids and functional elements are proteins. Most plasma membrane consists of 50% lipid and 50% protein by weight, with the carbohydrate portion of glycolipids and glycoproteins constituting 5 to 10% of the membrane mass. Since proteins are much larger than lipids, this percentage corresponds to about one protein per molecule of every 50 to 100 molecules of lipid. So because lipid has lower molecular weight than protein, the number of lipids required to equal the weight of the protein molecule is of the ratio of 50:1. For 50 molecules of lipids, there is one molecule of protein. So their weight is in the same ratio, but the numbers are not in the same ratio. In 1972, Jonathan Singer and Garth Nicholson, these two are important names, Jonathan Singer, I hope you may have heard them. And Garth Nicholson. They proposed the fluid mosaic model of the membrane structure, which is now generally accepted as the basic paradigm for the organization of all biological membranes. In this model, membranes are viewed as two-dimensional fluids in which proteins are inserted into lipid bilayers. So, two-dimensional fluids where proteins are inserted into lipid bilayers. So integral proteins are inserted into the lipid bilayer, whereas peripheral proteins are bound to the membrane indirectly by protein-protein interactions. So there are two types of proteins which we found in the plasma membrane. One is integral membrane proteins, they are inserted into the plasma membrane or the lipid bilayer. And number two is the peripheral proteins. They are bound to the membrane indirectly by protein-protein interactions. And most integral protein are transmembrane. That means they traverse the whole membrane. Their size is so big that they traverse both the bilayers. Singer and Nicholson distinguished two classes of membranes: associated proteins, which they call peripheral, and integral membrane proteins. Peripheral membrane proteins were operationally defined as proteins that dissociate from the membrane following treatment with polar reagents. Now, this is a very important point in understanding what is peripheral and what is integral. Peripheral membrane proteins were operationally defined as proteins that dissociate, that means separate, from the membrane following treatments with polar reagents. Polar reagents like HCl or any salt. So we can either give extreme pH or high salt concentration, but we have to make sure that we do not disrupt the phospholipid bilayer. Once dissociated from the membrane, the peripheral membrane proteins are soluble in aqueous buffers. So this is another character of peripheral membrane proteins, that they are soluble in aqueous buffers after dissociation from the membrane. These proteins are not inserted into the hydrophobic interior of the lipid bilayer. Again, not inserted. You can understand from the term peripheral. Periphery means lying on the boundary. So they are not inserted in the hydrophobic interior. They are indirectly associated with the membranes through protein-protein interaction. These interactions frequently involve ionic bonds, and they are generally disrupted by extreme pH or high salt concentration. In contrast to the peripheral membrane proteins, integral membrane proteins can be released only by treatments that disrupt the phospholipid bilayer. So this is again a very important point for integral membrane proteins. They can be released only by reagents that disrupt hydrophobic interactions. That means